Okay. Nein. Okay, hello everybody. Welcome to our talk, Funny Money. I'm speaking with Wolfgang Gorlick. I'm Drew Sutter. So the talk is about payment systems and what they can teach us about security.
Yeah, and so as well, that's really loud. Hello, everybody. These are excited. So I don't know if we want to adjust the volume just a tad on that. But the way this is going to work is I'm going to lay out an attack or something we've seen recently in the news or something we've investigated. And then from that, we're going to kick it over to Drew, who's going to say, hey, if you're building systems, here's what to think about. If you're breaking systems, here's something to play with. And then we'll do some Q&A, right? We'll have some discussion. We can take this wherever you guys want. We got four or five different things we'll cover, and this should be pretty interesting. These emerging payment systems, I mean, we're moving more and more money through them. And of course, why rob a bank? That's where the money is. We're into tokens first, right?
Yep.
Yeah, sweet. So everyone knows tokens. Tokens are great. PCI says we must token. Yes, thou shalt. Tokens are great. And one of the ways, or one of the reasons this came about, right, was TJX. You guys remember TJX? I love TJX. There's these guys, and they're hackers, and they're in their basement. It was like the Fox 2 news segment. It was awesome. And they stole tokens or stole credit cards. And the reason that worked was they had Wi-Fi. And was their Wi-Fi protected? No, it wasn't, right? It was like wireless encrypted protection. Fantastic. Thank you for letting us into your system. And not only that, but they had all the credit cards stored in the clear in centralized databases. And that may be like, oh, what were you guys thinking? But that was like 101. How do you do your systems? Well, we have the credit cards in the database so that we can do analytics. We can do tracking. We can see who purchased what. We can do rebates, all these sort of things. Well,
Let's skip around there.
who's clicking what? All right. So then they said, oh, no, we can't do that, right? That's bad. We got a token. So everyone tokenized, which is great. So we took these tokens that were mathematical formulas, just like password hashes. We applied this mathematical formula to the credit card. And now if you steal from a centralized database, that won't happen. So in theory, TJX should never ever happen again, right? 1 million credit cards on one database, never ever going to happen again. Why? Because of tokens. Where are these tokens being generated? Point of sale systems. So people swipe your card, we're still clear tech, track one, track two, swipe your card, and a token gets generated, gets moved out. So the criminals then go, oh, well, we can't get the databases anymore, we're going to quit. Which is a shame, because I was PCI compliant, I thought I was safe. No, they're like, wait. It's clear text on the terminal? Ah, I got an idea. Instead of attacking one database, we'll attack 1,000 different point of sale systems. And that's what they did. So in Target's case, they attacked 1,000 different point of sale systems, grabbed it at clear text before the tokenization occurred. And again, we had all these millions of databases taken out. So what's the point of this? As we apply security controls, right, as we move the token, as we move the ball around, we're not getting to the point where the bad guys are going to go home, right? They're not going to go, it's hard. Now I don't have my wireless equivalent protection anymore. What we're actually doing is fundamentally creating a better class of criminal, which is going to make things more interesting for all of us, both on the defense and the protection side. So what are some of the things with your defending you could do?
Right. So if you are thinking from like a builder's perspective, and when you're thinking about TJX and Target and tokenization, you need to think of your infrastructure as a whole. And that means all your architecture, all your systems, both on the client and the administration ends. And you have to keep in mind all the while where the data is going to be accessed. From the breaker side of things, when a new control is implemented, you should always focus on the endpoints. For example, with like tokenization, the credit card data was stored on the point of sale. Now it's at Visa or wherever else. Those are going to be the new targets. So in general, from the offensive side, focus on the IT infrastructure that the app is going to be touching and check for vulnerabilities. So this is kind of where like how the presentation is going to work. I mean, if you guys have questions about this on these builder and breaker slides, just shoot them off.
So one of the things I think about is interesting about that is that was like tokens are the silver bullet. Every token will be safe. And you're not going to be safe. There's going to be a new way to steal the killer text. Whenever we do end-to-end encryption, where do you attack? You attack at the ends. Right. So you will do a tokenization and involve the BCI project, you want to? Yeah, so how's it working?
It helps, but it's, you know, like you said, it's not the end. Mm-hmm. You know, you still got to secure the end. You've also got to make sure the developers aren't taking code home. There's all these other things that still apply.
The developers taking the code.
Yeah, on USB sticks.
Yes. Hypothetically. Yeah.
Hypothetically.
Right. Oh, and maybe we need some credit card data just to test.
Yeah,
right?
Precisely. That, test file.
That happens every once in a while. Yeah, so it's a mess.
Yeah, it helps, but it's not the answer.
Yeah, and where, if you don't mind me asking, where in the process are you applying the tokens?
Well, I apologize, I don't know all of it, because okay. I'm actually security trying to get these folks to think.
Lower the tokens.
Precisely.
Right.
Yeah. Yep. Also, because of misconception, too, when developers are working with tokenization, like, oh, PCI is out of scope, you don't have to worry about it.
Oh, that's a great point, right? So PCI says thou shalt token, and the honey that we've given them to apply the token is saying, if you tokenize, it's now out of scope. Right, which it won't be. It won't be. Because you can still create tokens, you can still inject processes, you can still do all sorts of evil stuff. Payment system must still be in scope, absolutely. And a good QSA would catch that. Come on in. No, it's perfect timing. Or use the back door. Okay. Maybe here there's free food from Gurkha.
Pizza.
Anything else on tokens before I jump forward? Someone's pointing over. Hey, I can see you. As a consumer outside?
Outside.
Yes. Speedway,
gas station.
Right. So cars, skimmers, who always look for that, that's 101. It's really hard. I use a very locked down credit card for anything outside, just for that reason. Don't use your debit card, we'll come back to that, but never ever use your debit card. It's very hard to tell, right? So as a consumer, when we swiped in the park today, do we know that they're doing the right thing with those credit cards? I hope they are. But having audited many, many times those systems where all we know is swiping and, oh, it's out of scope, but we've given them an internet access point. And because it's out of scope, we're not really tracking that. And it's an internet access point, and they're way over there, so maybe they need Wi-Fi. And
another thing, too, is if you're using debit cards and you kind of have to use a debit or a credit card in those situations, because the infrastructure is not there yet where you can use a more secure payment system on the consumer side of it, set up alerting. Set up like an alert if you use your debit card, anytime it gets used, set up alerts so that as soon as your debit card is used anywhere, you get them right to your phone.
And you can have any cashless.
From those alerts, you can lock it too, right?
Yeah, you can lock it down.
Very good point. All right, go to tokens. So whenever you're doing end-to-end, you move the endpoint. So we've had a million credit cards in a database. Now we've got a million credit cards spread across 1,000 different point-of-sale systems. Now with things like Apple Pay, you've got the token on your phone, right? So now if they want to get that same amount of data, they no longer have to attack one database or 1,000 kiosks. Now they have to attack a million phones, which is pretty interesting. So we've done some work with that point. That's one of the things that Drew worked on earlier this year.
So the way that tokens work in Apple Pay is it's like a one-time use thing. It's you're not transmitting the real credit card data when you pay. It's just tokenized information. It's really only clear text when you onboard the credit card. When you originally you get your iPhone, you take a picture of your credit card, it's clear text then. So that's something to keep in mind. And so, you know, that sounds better than credit cards. And for the most part, we found that to be true. But to really understand how Apple Pay and credit cards and payments in general work, you have to understand the payment process. And the biggest part of that that we've come to realize is payment gateway service providers. And you may not even know what that is. Essentially, it's a service that you can integrate with your app to, they'll help route the data. They'll help route the data through the complex credit card transmission process. They're just entities that help route that. And the primary one that we researched was AuthorizeNet. there are many, many, many more pieces to this puzzle. So as I said before, the customer first onboards their credit card using their iPhone's camera. After this, the payments can be made. When the customer taps their iPhone with the tokenized information at a payment terminal or makes an internet-based purchase, AuthorizeNet or a similar, you know, gateway will pass the tokenized information to the payment processor, which is also referred to as the merchant-side bank. Then it is subsequently passed to a credit card network, such as Visa. The credit card network translates the tokenized information into real credit card data and sends the transaction only the dollar amount needed back to the bank that issued the credit card to the customer, which is referred to as the issuing side bank. The bank approves or declines the transaction based on the customer's available funds, like I said before, and relays the information back to the credit card network again, and then it is passed to the merchant side bank or the payment processor. And then finally, the information, just the dollar amount needed, is sent back to AuthorizeNet and the purchase is made. So now that you sort of know, I know that's pretty complex, it's confusing, and it may not exactly make sense when you first hear it, but it's Googleable. You can totally find that online. So now that you know how this works, how can you break the system? So what I did, and Wolf helped too, was I set up a simulated environment with the payment gateway service provider, AuthorizeNet, and an integrated web page to accept payments. Then I performed static analysis on the code, and I did find some vulnerabilities, but nothing that would have led to actually exploiting the application. But if you were to exploit the application, what would you look for? So from an attacker's perspective, there are really four key areas of interest when thinking about Apple Pay and tokenized payments. The first two deal with the actual credit card data, so when and where it's accessible in plain text. This happens during the onboarding process, like I said. So think about what you could do there. If you had a piece of malware on an iPhone, you could capture the credit card data when it's onboarded. Another interesting spot to look for is at the end of the transaction, when the tokenized information is translated into real data. So, you know, moving the target, creating the better class of criminal, you have before people going after the point of sale, now is more of the efforts going to be concentrated on the server side, so where Visa's storing the credit card data. So the third area of interest, though, is AuthorizeNet, so that gateway I talked about before. AuthorizeNet stands at a pivotal point in the transaction because it receives the tokenized information for the purchase and then passes it on and receives approval based solely on the appropriate funds from Visa. This means that if AuthorizeNet was compromised, the tokenized information could theoretically be intercepted and used illicitly. So, for example, after compromising AuthorizeNet, the attacker could use the intercepted token to do something else. So this would be like passing the token almost. If someone's making a purchase, like let's say online, and you have compromised AuthorizeNet, you could take that token, pass it to the credit card network, and then buy something else with it. So that's, I think, the most important area to concentrate on. It seems like the weakest point right now. But there's also hash tables. So hash tables for tokens, because tokens are mathematically derived. It's basically they take your credit card number and then they perform a mathematical function to change into something else. So if you're able to figure out what the, you know, reverse engineer that, figure out how these tokens are being generated, you potentially could get the plain text data from the token. So this was an instance where Apple Pay, and you were going to speak to this with the Apple Pay for the, they actually did Apple Pay fraud with the landline.
Yeah, so the other thing I thought was interesting about this was a throwback attack, right? So if you think about pass the hash, that's cool. We've been doing that with passwords for a while. Think about rainbow tables, that's cool. We've been doing that for, you know, passwords for a while. Oh, wait, we can apply that to credit card data. That's pretty cool. And that got me thinking about some of these other throwback accounts and attacks, like phone phreaking, right? You guys remember phone phreaking, Captain Crunch, right? Blowing a whistle, getting free phones. I love that. I love that. I saw like War Games when I was a kid. I'm like, I want to be that guy. and some of the old phone freaking techniques was like hijacking someone's phone, right? You could call and you could pretend to be someone, they reroute it. I mean, Mitnick would do this all the time. We are actually seeing Apple Pay fraud using this old phone freak. And I hope to God they're using Captain Crunch whistle too. Because so here's what it is, right? The way you add a device is I say, Drew, I'm going to use your wallet. And I take an iPhone, I'm going to go, okay, I want to be part of Drew's wallet, and I request to add it. All right? And when that add goes through, it goes, wait, to authorize your Apple Pay device, we're going to call you. And it calls that landline. Hi, your code is, you got it. So as you might imagine, what people are doing is they target someone, they get the creds, right, brute force creds, we've been doing this forever, and they take their phone number, and they port it, and then they call up, and they pretend to be that person, and they move the wallet. So kind of cool. I mean, very small fraud, but it's ongoing fraud. It's one of the first attacks we saw on Apple Pay. And in any case, as we're developing this better class of criminals, the old crimes still pay, right? The old ones are still good.
So with that in mind, to protect against the majority of attacks, you need to secure your code, and static analysis is a great place to start, and other forms of analysis too, but you need to think of the overall architecture, because again, like with the phone phreaking thing, that was overlooked. It wasn't really expected to, they're overlooking those old attacks. And so you really need to keep in mind consumer processes and how does the application interact with the customer. So like, is there a weak point somewhere in your application? From the breaker side of it, the examples like the phone porting one show that these old school attacks are overlooked. And attacking the application at source using old attacks on new systems is a way to discover unnoticed vulnerabilities. So again, if you guys have any questions on these slides we've covered, just go ahead.
Who's an Apple Pay user in here? Couple people? I was not going to do it. I was like, something new is going to be evil. That's what I'm waiting for. I'm going to get a new iPhone.
Wait for version 2.
I'm waiting for version. That's what I hear. But so going into this, I'm like, oh, yeah, Apple Pay. I'm going to trust Apple with my credit cards. And as I started looking at the tokenization and whatnot, and I realized I don't have a landline. it's interesting as they're applying these new techniques. So, anyone have any questions for the LAMP setup or the way the tokens are passed?
You can steal a token from gateway authorized.
Yeah.
Is it only good for the amount that?
No, it's not, because you think about it, just the logical process. When they're paying for it, they're going to send that to Visa, and they're going to check if you have the available funds. And then they send it back. So you could really make a purchase for the amount, whatever you want.
So tokenization is on the Stripe event.
Right.
Now with Apple Pay and these new forms of payment, I know in Europe you use chip and pin. Is that a replacement, or is chip and pin still the best way to kind of protect it on your side? And does it do anything farther up the line, or is it still generating tokens?
It's working. I mean, the credit card data is encrypted on the chip and PIN cards, but with, I think actually Apple Pay is more secure because you're transmitting encrypted information. It's not, some work with tokens too, but with Apple Pay, you're really never transmitting the real data unless someone is going to break the token algorithm, which hasn't been done yet. But from what I've researched, I would consider Apple Pay more secure than chip and PIN cards. Yeah.
Have you compared Apple Pay with like Google Wallet?
To some extent, yeah. They had tokenization before Apple Pay, but Apple Pay's algorithm is supposed to be better. The thing is that now they're revamping their system. They're going to have like Google Pay, but we'll see where it goes. But right now, I'd still say Apple Pay is more secure than Google
That's
Wallet.
One of the things we want to blow into the lab, right? So when he's talking about setting up the payment system and the virtual phone and tracking the information, all that is very easy to do with Android. Obviously, people have been doing Android emulation forever. From one hand, so as the new Google Wallet comes out, SDK, we definitely be pulling it down.
Yeah.
Because I don't think the Google using hardware security device on there.
I believe the idea is to have the TSM, the hardware security device, right, as part of the new Android platform stuff.
Yeah.
Because Google Wallet's wallet started off as ISIS and SoftCard, now Google Wallet. Have you tested any of the previous?
Haven't tested ISIS or SoftCard, no. Just done research on Google Wallet, but mostly concentrated on Apple Pay. Yeah.
If Apple Pay uses one token, one-time token, how do you reuse it?
you can't reuse it. But the one time you use it, you would be able to use it for that one purchase. So you wouldn't be able to, like, once you steal the token, you wouldn't be able to apply it to another purchase after that because it is one-time use. It changes periodically.
So the point being is that right now we move the attacker down to trying to attack the phone. But if you look up the stream, if you can attack high enough, like the authorized net and whatnot, where there's lots of tokens, if you can intercept those, you can make different charges on each one of those tokens as they're coming across.
If.
But I would definitely expect to see an attack like that. That's going to be the next target, the next TJ Maxx, I would say.
So with the tokens being one-time use, and if somebody does intercept the token, and you're on the terminal side, would it come back like a transaction guide? Some kind of clue that something's going on that maybe you should be aware of?
It depends really on their system, like the point-of-sale system. But if you – I was thinking more with the online – purchase. So like if you were buying something online and you had a compromised authorized net, you would be able to approve a purchase for something else, but it wouldn't, the customer, it would be an error probably on their side, yes, but the but your purchase would be approved.
Sweet. So let's go on to a couple more. Starbucks. Did anyone go to the Converge after party last night? Yeah, I got it like after 3. I was so bummed when I found the Starbucks was here. It was closed. I'm like, no, let me in. I love my Starbucks, though. So, Starbucks is great, right? We all love Starbucks. Starbucks has this mobile app, which is great, and everyone loves mobile apps. And they're one of the first ones to have mobile apps. And there's this cute little mobile app that you can swipe to get your phone. They give you points. And they're like, hey, we want more people who use this app to use this app. So like, hey, I'm going to give you a gift card, John, and you can give someone else a gift card, right? And it evolved that way. And this tiny little app that was just, you know, a good little pet project is now processing $2 billion annually in funds. Move this little cute thing to $2 billion. So as you might imagine, there's a big, big target on Starbucks now. And as Drew was talking about, those consumer processes, right? How people are using it that ends up being very interesting weak links to exploit. So what we saw with Starbucks earlier this year was gift card fraud. So Z, I'm gonna pick on you.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm gonna try and guess your password. maybe it's your puppy, maybe it's your I don't know, maybe it's so hard, you know. I'm gonna try and guess your password until I get it. And once I do, you've got Starbucks. And I'm gonna take your Starbucks, and you're gonna give me a gift card. Because right? You lied to me. You can prove that, right? Let's go. So now I got a gift card. So I steal her password, I log into her account, I give me a gift card, and then I sell that gift card on the black market. Okay? Now that doesn't scale very well, and Z is going to kind of figure out what's going on after a while. But now I'm going to automate this. Right? So maybe she changed her password, maybe she does something cool. I'm going to password crack everyone in Detroit with the password one. Right? And how many people am I going to get? Maybe a couple good percentage. Because all of my Starbucks app, I don't really care. I just, whatever was easy to type in my iPhone at the time. And then, because it's a botnet, I'm going to script, I'm going to load a gift card. But why am I only going to do one gift card? That's kind of lame. I'm going to do as many gift cards as I can off that one person until their account gets locked. Right? And then I'm going to sell those gift cards. And that's what's happened. People have built Starbucks botnets that are attacking Starbucks accounts and doing this, and it gets hundreds of cards in a minute until you go broke. I mean, it just will drain your account. Which reminds me, Drew's point is good for alerts. That works. They do this so fast, sometimes the alerts don't go through.
Yeah.
So if you guys like do nothing else, and if you are using Starbucks, and Starbucks is great, don't get me wrong, they fixed a lot of this, but don't use your debit card. Because debit card does not have the same consumer protection as the credit card. So anyone who this happened to on the credit card side, they're like, oh well, and the credit card reimbursed them. It's the debit users who really got slammed. The debit users with password 101.
So I asked my bank about that, and I said, yeah, that's true, the losses don't have to be identified.
It depends on your bank.
Right.
Tell me afterwards what your bank is.
I know that Chase has some protections for it, but in general, credit cards are...
The law doesn't protect you, but many banks...
Many banks will.
Big banks.
Yeah.
Will. So you don't have to panic. You have to be careful.
Yeah.
So it's a very good point. So some banks are having protections, but still.
But you're at the bank's mercy, essentially.
And so when this hit the news, everyone's like, oh, well, just tell people not to have passwords or password one. And we've been doing that for years, and that doesn't work. It really is more than that. We've got to look at a much broader range of controls.
So, I mean, thinking about Starbucks from a builder perspective, again, consumer processes need to be considered with an app like Starbucks because how does the consumer interact with the application? Are there flaws in the consumer process? And the key here is the thresholding activities, because if you're able to reapply for this, you know, get these credit cards over and over and over again, and if it refills 10 times in like a minute, let's say, this should raise some flags. These controls need to be built into the app. So you need to revisit the old controls, because when the app started out, it's just a small app that, you know, maybe they thought it'd be nice to use, but now it's processing $2 billion. So the controls need to be readjusted when your app grows like that. From the breaker side, from the attacker's perspective, play with the boundaries of the app. What can you do and what can't you do? Look at little appreciated features of the app, little unknown usages that you might be able to get access to things that you didn't know before. You could find vulnerabilities in the app that way.
So what I'm going to do, and I apologize, I'm going to zip through the next couple of slides because I just look and stay close to noon, and I'm smelling the good kind of food. So I'm going to go through the next ones a little bit fast so we can end up pretty close in time. And Drew, you're around all day, right?
Yep.
So hit him off with questions, hit me up with questions. Even when all goes right, and I loved your story about hypothetical developers taking home code, because it's always those old attacks, right? Those old good ones that kind of are throwbacks. Like what happened in Woolworth. So Woolworth has a gift card system, which is great. I don't know if it's susceptible to the same thing, but what I do know about their gift cards is that they were hacked, and compromised by a sophisticated persistent attacker. My favorite sophisticated persistent attacker, Excel, made a spreadsheet of a whole bunch of people who were using this with the link to go ahead and redeem or reset the card, and exposed $1.3 million worth of gift cards in one spreadsheet sent to over 1,000 different people accidentally by a user. So, yeah, good on them, right? Even when things are good,
right,
you have a human error.
Right. I mean, that's what it is. It's because even if you have all the controls you need, and we don't necessarily know if Woolworth has those, the human error needs to be taken into account, because you still have that human problem. The value of like training programs and things and telling people not to send out spreadsheets with all this information is can't be overstated. And again, from the breaker side, even if it seems, if an app seems unbeatable, just target the humans, because people make mistakes and there's countless ways to interact and manipulate that.
So that gets us to Current C. You want to just give a brief overview?
Yeah. So Current C is a new payment system coming out. It's not out yet. It's being developed by a conglomeration of retailers. It's going to use tokenized bank information instead of credit card information. Users link their app to their bank account and tokenized information is sent to the point of sale. So Current C uses QR codes, which transmit the tokenized information. They can use that to make payments. One of the issues, though, is the Current C is actually storing your real bank information on their servers. So it's the moving target again. It's the same trend of you have it tokenized somewhere, and now all of a sudden it's the real data is stored on their server, so that's the new target. So storing the data in the cloud is obviously going to attract attackers, and it's putting the target on their back. So Current C hasn't received a lot of, it's not very popular right now. It's not even out yet, just because of that fact. So from the builder's perspective, the data's got to exist somewhere, currencies, servers. And from the attacker's perspective, that's obviously where you're going to be concentrating your efforts. So just a summary, these are the lessons learned from the builder side throughout these examples that we've shown. You need to secure your code. You got to focus on where the data is actually stored. Reduce the number of repositories. What I mean by that is, like, the data already has to exist at Visa or your bank. So in Current C's example, why are you storing the data on their servers too? So you're duplicating the data. You got to reduce the amount of places that you're storing data. And then also never forget that humans make mistakes. And in the reversed, from the attacker's perspective, realize that humans make mistakes, test the boundaries of the app, attack the code, and if there's a new control, focus on the endpoint. So, you know, with the tokenization, focus on where the data is stored now.
this is an interesting space for us, right? We're seeing this expand. There's all sorts of things. You mentioned Snapchat.
Yeah, with Snapchat now, you can send money to someone else. Like with Snapchat, you just like put a dollar sign in the number of, you know, money you want to send to them. So there's all these new ways developing.
Right, and Brad was telling me about the whole selfie to get your bank information. I love that.
Get that face.
They are just giving money. In Oslo, they've got like window shopping, like hashtag window shopping, where you download an app and you walk around downtown. You're like, I like that. You take a picture of the QR code and it automatically buys it from you. I can imagine that's got to have some fun stuff. Right? So as we're trying as an industry to capture some of the revenue that has traditionally flown through banks. And we talked for years and years about on Wi-Fi wireless or wired equivalent protections. We need bank equivalent protections. But Starbucks is not a bank. Snapchat is not a bank. But they're trying to because that's where the money is. You make some revenue.
Right.
So watch the space. It's going to be very exciting.
So all this stuff is utterly terrifying and makes me paranoid. So I have a question. You guys, having done all this research regarding personal operational security of your credit cards, what would give you, distill this down into like a top three? You know, the top three best practices for a consumer.
Top three, always use credit cards. Have instead of
instead of debit cards.
Instead of debit cards.
Okay.
Apple Pay is okay.
Okay.
And set up your alerts.
Yeah. That's also a good option.
I was stuck in Detroit yesterday because no one would let me park because I didn't have cash. Like, take my credit card. I'll give you a token, bud. They wouldn't buy it.
What about auto refill, like in the Starbucks app? Turn that off.
Turn off auto refill.
Yeah, definitely.
Yep. All right, guys, and I think our number one tip would be enjoy lunch from Gurkha.
Yeah, pizza.
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming out.